that's a little rough, yes.
All right, that's all. That's all we did. One more minute, y'all, and we'll get the party started. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to Bonita / Garrison United Methodist Churches, our June 14th service. It's our second service since the reboot. So glad y'all are here, whether you're here physically or whether you're online watching. We're glad you're here. And we welcome you. The good news is, wherever you are, God is there. And you can reach out and grab hold of Him anytime, anywhere. So thank God for that. But we're glad to be back with you. One announcement for today is next Sunday, Garrison will be starting their services back as well. So we'll be having 11 o'clock in Garrison. We hope to be doing it on Facebook Live as well for all those folks up there. If they can't make it, that they can come. There will be, for the Garrison people, there will be a Zoom meeting tomorrow night at 6 o'clock to discuss what the restart looks like. You know, just like the Bonita Church had to do. We kind of kicked around some ideas, but anyway, there's some things we have to do to kind of, you know, keep everybody safe and everything. So anyway, we did have a Zoom meeting last Sunday night after this service. We seemed to think everything mostly went really well. The only observation was that a lot of folks, besides me, of course I can't wear a mask, so I'm way away from y'all. But there was a tendency to pull the mask down below your nose. And so I get it. Janet does have some of the paper masks that might be a little more comfortable for that, so that you don't have to, you know, pull it down. I don't know how much effectiveness is lost by that. I don't know. But anyway, just if you can, keep it up, you know. If you can't, you can't. We understand. Are there any other just administrative type announcements this week that need to be made? We'll do prayer concerns in just a minute. So anything else going on? Okay, all right. So by the way, just a reminder, the offering is being taken on the back table, either as you come in or as you leave, or you get up in the middle of service. If you don't want to forget it, like me, And drop it in there. You can mail it to the P.O. Box. That's what many have started doing. I'd encourage you to do that. That's what I have to do, just so, you know, I remember to do it. We just have one of those bank checks go every month or whatever and into the P.O. Box. So I encourage you to consider doing that. And that way, whatever happens, you know, you'll still still gives your tithe to the church. So, anything else? Okay, so we have a call to worship this morning. So it's a little different that for the Bonita folks, Garrison folks are used to this. So here we go. And then it's got a, it's a responsive reading, right? So if you will, I'll read the regular print, and if you will softly, you know, read the bold print with me. Okay, we're going to do a couple of those today. So we're going to do a psalter also. So anyway, just, you know, you don't have to holler it out. Just keep it kind of low. But anyway, okay, y'all with me? Okay, so raise your voices in response to God's goodness.
We praise you, O Lord, for all the blessings you have given us.
Lift your hearts in sweet surrender to God's mercy.
We thank you, O Lord, for hearing the prayers of our hearts.
God is good. Praise be to God.
The love and mercy of God never fails. Amen.
All right, so prayer concerns. This has kind of been a rocky experience a little bit during the COVID-19, trying to get prayer concerns out and keeping up with it. So here's what I have, and we can add to the list, so please help me. Hobson family and the loss of Lane's mom, Kelly and Tyler Rayburn, going, you know, various issues there. Bill Pierce, Gene Pierce, Gene is still recovering from her surgery and all. Bill has to go to Houston on Tuesday, has an appointment at Methodist Hospital. He's been hoarse, and it has something to do with the vertebrae in his neck pushing on his vocal cord. So he has an appointment with a specialist down there at Methodist Hospital Tuesday morning. Let's see, Marie Thomas family, Judy Corley is having some tests run. Kim talked to her yesterday. I believe Dr. LeDay is... is he fighting a cancer battle or something?
He is, and he will be going to Houston, and they'll do some things for him down there, and he'll stay for a while, and then he'll come home.
And a lot of people use Dr. LeDay here in town, so.
He's actually retired, and he's having a bone marrow transplant.
Okay. So, retired and having a bone marrow transplant. Kaylee Johnson and her baby were in some distress last week. I don't remember who brought that forward, but let's see. Jim Buckingham has had a bone marrow transplant and is past day 50, I believe, and it seems to be doing pretty well. Kim had her, Kim had her scan week and a half, 2 weeks ago now, and there's no cancer anywhere else, but they said that the spot where they treated, you know, the radiation and all that, is well, they want to think it's scar tissue that is piling. So it's like 98% it's probably scar tissue, but they want her to come back in 3 months and have a PET scan just to be sure. So, you know, keep her lifted up. Rhett Russell is a young child from here in Central Heights that had some problems. That'd be, I believe, at Texas Children's, but I think he's better now. We'll keep him on there. Doug Schumick is a friend of James Sokolaven's, military friend from Marines that is, he's stage 4 cancer in his own hospice. Vi Alexander lost her brother this week. Keep them lifted up. My brother Gary they did a scan on his liver this week and they're waiting for the results on that. Yeah. Our nursing homes, Jimmy Payne from Garrison Church has been going through some treatment for esophageal cancer. Tommy Collins is another friend of Garrison Church. The United States of America right now, right? And the United Methodist Church. So, anyway, Any others?
Mike? Brooklyn Drury.
Brooklyn Drury?
Drury, yes, that's a cow and Claire's daughter. She's about 6 months old, or 7 months. They're in Philadelphia. She had a problem at birth. The baby was fine, but Claire had a problem, and the baby was damaged on her arm. Has no movement at all. So they went to Philadelphia and had surgery about 2 months ago or so. And they're back up there now, so it's really a hard situation.
Brooklyn Drury, gotcha, okay.
Terry Sims family?
Carrie?
No, Terry.
Terry Sims family, okay. It's kind of hard to hear with those masks all over the others. Anyways, yes, ma'am.
Mark Madden.
Mark, okay.
He can't get rid of that kidney infection, so it's still ongoing.
He's had fear, hasn't he?
Yep.
Anybody else? Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Holy God, we come before you today. We thank you and praise you for all the blessings that you poured into our lives, especially the gift of Jesus to us, that we might be saved by faith in him, might be forgiven, might be made right with you through his blood shed at Calvary. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we lift up all these folks that we mentioned that are on our hearts and minds today. We pray for you to pour out your healing upon them, that they would be lifted up, that they would be blessed, healed, watched over, protected, provided for, and Lord, that you would just put a hedge protection around them and bless them and lift them up from their infirmity. Lord, and for our nation, we pray, Lord, at this time, we pray for our national leaders, our president, we pray for all those in positions of authority, we pray for our mayors and governors, that this stressful time, Lord, we pray for an end to racial discrimination, we pray for racism to go away and be a distant memory in our nation. We do pray for our law enforcement. We believe most of our law enforcement are really great people. And we understand that there are some that are not, and we pray that they would be dealt with in a way that's pleasing to you and not be a problem to our nation anymore or to anyone. We pray that you would continue to work in the United Methodist Church, that you continue to help us to bring healing and hope, salvation, your truth to the world, and be a blessing to all people everywhere. We pray that you would work in our hearts and lives here at the Bonita and Garrison United Methodist Churches, that we'd be a light. We would be a light to the nations, that we would be a light in our communities, and that we would hold on to you and trust in you through your Son Jesus, who taught us how to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Okay. So here's the Psalter. So this might be something a little new. It's a psalm, that's what it is. So this is the psalm for this week. It's Psalm 116. And I'll read this. And if the first verse is every other verse, alternating verses, y'all help me with the second verse and so on. It's in larger print too. Okay. I love the Lord who has heard my voice and my supplications
and has inclined his ear to me. Whenever I call,
what shall I return to the Lord for all my benefits?
I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord.
I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord
is the death of his faithful ones. Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant. The child of your handmaid, you have loosed my bonds. I will offer to you the sacrifice of thanksgiving and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst, O Jerusalem. Praise the Lord.
The Psalms speak to us, don't they? They lift us up. They help us. They speak to us in our circumstances. David had such keen insight and was so plugged into the Lord that he still speaks to us now through the words that he penned thousands of years ago now. So we're going to do our music portion. I want to say a special thank you to Don Clark, who has graciously recorded some music and sent it to me so that we could use that so that we're not having to do live music at this point in time. And there's the second song I wanted to kind of give you a lead in for came a month or so ago, American Idol, ironically. The young lady who won American Idol this year, her name is Just Sam, and she's a young African-American lady from New York City. And if you get a chance, look this up on YouTube or whatever. Look up the story, her story. She sings in the subway in New York City. That's what she does to provide for her family. She's raised by her grandmother and sings there in the subway. And she actually had a breakdown when she was auditioning with Lionel Richie and all those, and Katy Perry and all. And they came up and she prayed. They prayed together and allowed her to go on with a new song. And her, you'll see her singing with kind of her mentor, if you will, or the person she looked up to. They sing a duet together. Anyway, I won't give too much away, but it's a beautiful story. I think you'll might be something you can check on when you get home. So, all right, here's the song.
Love Jesus to reach out. that is.
If I recall correctly, Just Sam tried to sing that for her audition. She couldn't, she broke down because it was so powerful music to her. So. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Holy God, you alone are God. You alone are King. You alone are righteous and holy. And we need you, Lord. You speak to us and tell us that we are worthy of your salvation, that we are your children, that we have eternal life within us. Our down payment is your Holy Spirit that lives within. What a blessing you have given to us, O God. Help us, Lord, to realize the salvation you give, how awesome it is to know you, to be forgiven, and to have peace with you. Not only now, but for all eternity. Lord, I pray that you would speak to our hearts this day and help us all to understand a little better today just what that is, what it means. And maybe, someone will open their hearts to you today. We pray for them. Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so here's the scripture, y'all. So we normally say it together, so maybe we can not do that today, so give y'all a little rest. So I'll read the scripture today. Therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. Because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege where we now stand. We confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory. We can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials, but we know that they help us develop endurance. And endurance develops strength of character. Character strengthens our confident hope of salvation, and this hope will not lead to disappointment, for we know how dearly God loves us, because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. When we were utterly hopeless, Christ came at just the right time and died for us sinners. Now most people would not be willing to die for an upright person, though someone might perhaps be willing to die for a person who is especially good. But God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. And since we have been made right in God's sight by the blood of Christ, he will certainly save us from God's condemnation. For since our friendship with God was restored by the death of his Son, while we were still his enemies, we will certainly be saved through the life of his Son. So now we can rejoice in our wonderful new relationship with God because our Lord Jesus Christ has made us friends of God. This is Romans 5, 1 through 11. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Celebrate. So COVID-19 forced us to our homes to stay for a while, right? Fear had the upper hand as we awaited the worst. Gloom and doom was the prophecy from the infectious disease community, as predictions of as many as 2 million dying in the U.S. alone. Right? Y'all remember that when this first started? Concern for stressing out the nation's hospital resources pervaded the day, and we responded by recoiling from public exposure. Paper products, ironically enough, were immediately in short supply amid of all things. Anyway, hand sanitizer, Lysol spray, and Lysol wipes were impossible to get. If you had them in stock at the time when everything went down, you know, you were you were blessed to just have some. We seem to be waiting for some inevitable calamity to slam us and to take us on the rest of the way. Although the dark days of COVID-19 are still with us, haven't gotten completely beyond it yet, we have a new hope that we can prevail if we practice hand washing, social distancing, and wear masks while we're in public, which, you know, y'all are doing today. And hopefully I read the last couple of days where the companies have been contracted with to ramp up and get ready for the vaccine. They're already signing contracts for companies and getting them the packaging for them has already been contracted. It's coming, so they're getting ready for that. And we have a hope that we can make it, and we can get a vaccine, and everything's going to be okay, right? We'll be restored to somewhat normalcy, right? But even though we've lost 100,000 people in the U.S., thank goodness the predictions of 2 million dead haven't been realized, and seem to be just a little more than a worst-case scenario. So utterly helpless, Paul talks about us being utterly helpless in this passage. Maybe we can begin to get a sense of how it was before there was hope of salvation through Christ. We were held hostage by sin and unable to break free of its dark grip on our lives. Kind of like this COVID-19 fear and trauma and all that. We were afraid to face God and have his wrath poured out on us for all that we had done wrong in our lives. So I've shared with y'all before that I was raised in a little, hellfire and brimstone church, in South Alabama. How you can kind of latch on to part of what's said and kind of let the bulk of it just go over your head. I think that's what I did a lot of times, because it was in the talking about sin and what have you that I grabbed hold of that. And I ended up with a distorted view of who God was and what it meant to be saved. I'm not blaming anybody else but myself. But that's how I walked out of that church when I was 18. And honestly, I felt hopeless. I thought, if you've got to be perfect to be saved, then there's no hope for me. I can't do that. I can't be that person. So I gave up, right? I gave up. And again, it was my problem. And it wasn't until I got slammed with some personal doubts and calamities and what have you, that I finally just approached God on my own. And I found out that my perception of who God was all wrong. That God is a loving God, a merciful God, and he forgives any and all sin. We just need to come to him and let Jesus do that work that we can't do. We can't make ourselves perfect. There's no way. And I came away from that experience feeling much differently about God and knowing that, it is possible. There is hope. We're not utterly hopeless. So scripture says, Paul says, no one is righteous, not even one, right? Not any of us are righteous. My camera person is trying to tell me something. I don't know what she's saying. Louder. Okay. All right. So nobody's righteous, not even one. So none of us is going to get there because we're good sinless people. We can't do it, right? So, you know, as we look around the world and we see situations around us, I'm going to mention the George Floyd incident. We've probably all seen the pictures or video or something like that. And that situation should have never happened. But you know what? Sin got in the way. And sin got involved in that and warped it and made it something horrible that should have never been, right? The riots that are happening right now, I mean, sin is warping them and taking them in a direction that they shouldn't go. I mean, protests are great, but burning down communities really is not good. It's not helpful. That is, so our families are in crisis at this point in time. Sin is wrecking our homes and has been for quite some time. There were, 21% of children being raised today are being raised by a single mother. 21%. 25% are being raised by a single parent. And of course, some of that is by the other spouse being deceased, right? I mean, so that's in the future too. But our families are fractured. Grandmamas are raising kids. It's a mess. Our families are falling apart. We're under such stress right now. And we're seeing some of that. That's, sin is warping all of that. It's largely due to sin, I'm going to say. So, made right by the blood of Christ, though. Made right by the blood of Christ. So, young Ryan Matthews, the young man in these pictures, was, he and a friend of his were picked up in Louisiana. Ryan was 17. He was charged with murder, with robbing a store and killing a clerk. They were driving a vehicle that was similar in color to the vehicle that robbed the store. Wasn't the same make or model. But they ended up being taken in for questioning, and he never got out. He was charged, convicted of murder, sentenced to death. Served 5 years in Louisiana death row before the DNA evidence came out that cleared him, and he was exonerated of all charges. And this is a picture of him back in December. He graduated from the Texas Women's University, which was in Dallas, or wherever it is. So anyway, it's a happy ending, right? And he says, I'm not blaming anyone. He said, I don't hold anger or bitterness in my heart. He said, I know what that will do to people. And he said, I don't want that to do that to me. So he's making the best of the situation, right? And thank God that he has. Scripture tells us again, Jesus tells us in John 8, so if the Son sets you free, you are truly free, right? For us, it's kind of like we were convicted of murder and sentenced to death for our sins. We've all sinned, right? We've all rebelled against God and done the wrong thing. As a human race, we have done that. But it's like Jesus allowed his DNA to be applied to our case so that we might be acquitted of all charges. He says, take my DNA. I'm the one. I'll take the guilt for their crime, and I'll pay the price for it. And which allows us to be set free. Jesus took the penalty for our sins. He took our death sentence. And by his own blood, he bought us and set us free. If the Son has set you free, you are free indeed. There's another interpretation of that passage. free to live the life abundant that comes through faith in Jesus Christ, free from the bondage to sin that we were under as the Spirit of God now leads us, free from death and alive forevermore. Now, Jesus tells us in John's Gospel, chapter 11, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, though they die, yet shall they live, and those who live and believe in me will never die. So, what do we make of that? If you're a believer, and we will all, this physical body will eventually pass away, right? I mean, this is going to happen. Unless the Lord comes back, we will pass away. But the instant before this body experiences that death of event, our spirits are taken away and just float out of this body and go to be with Jesus. We don't die. We don't experience death. We live, our spirits live forevermore. And when God looks at us and sees the Holy Spirit mingled with our spirit, he says, you're in, you're one of my children. You get a free pass to heaven because my son has paid the price for your sins. You're a child of mine. So we're free to live without fear. Free to follow Christ wherever he leads us. Free to reign with Christ forever here on earth and in heaven. Wherever that is, we will be with him forever. Is that worth saying amen to?
Amen.
All right. Okay. So, rejoice in our new relationship with Christ. I mentioned to y'all my son Bobby's, technically he's a stepson, but when he graduated from high school, he was a disaster. You know, he was a mess. Lord have mercy. For years after, I mean, when he was 25, I was like, I mean, we prayed for him, and really, it's one of those situations like, Lord, you're just right there with him. I don't know what to do. You know, he moved in with his girlfriend. He was, you know, flunked out of school. I mean, it was just this ongoing mess. And all of a sudden, when he met his wife, Amy, and they started seeing each other, he started talking differently. He started walking differently. He and she, they went to a church in Huntsville. They got saved. They got their life right with God. And he finished college and graduated. He has a great job in Arlington now. He's got two sons. And he's an awesome dad and husband. He takes his family to church on Sunday. He's in a Bible study. It's like, wow. Hallelujah, you know, this is something I could have never done, you know, even though I wanted that so desperately for him. And it's so nice to be around him now and to see him and his family and the dynamics that are going on there and how loving and caring that they are with those boys and all that with each other. So it's kind of like, in some small way, in a much bigger way, I guess, that Jesus has given us a new relationship with God, right? I mean, he has changed us. He has transformed us from the inside out so that our relationship with God now isn't one where we're running around in fear of God and trying to hide from God and not want God to see what we're up to, right? And thinking we can hide things and just sneak around. Now we want God involved in everything, right? We want him there. We invite him to be there with us, to help us, to lead us. We pray to him at all times, in all places, in all situations. Jesus has given us a new relationship with God. We don't have to live in fear of the wrath of God. Now, we should have holy awe and respect of God, right? I mean, even so. We should look up to him and worship him, but we don't have to live in fear of his wrath anymore. Because of Jesus, we are, as Paul says, friends of God. So when I was
He raised up in Florida, Alabama. My grandma and granddaddy lived right next door, and or at least for part of that time, we moved closer to them, so we'd be close. And I don't know if y'all remember, this was back in the 60s, 70s. Things were a little different back then. People used to sit out on the front porch and jail bees together in the afternoons and evenings. You know, neighbors would come over and visit with you, and maybe they'd sit down, pull up a rocking chair and help you shell peas, that kind of thing. I don't know if y'all, I'm sure some of y'all can remember that. But we had, my grandmother had a friend named Miss Barlow. And Miss Barlow, I mean, we could be sitting down to eat Sunday dinner. We might be watching TV in the living room. Miss Barlow, it didn't matter to her. She'd come, open the door, and just come in. Just walk right in, never knocked. She'd just come on in the house and just join in with whatever was going on. That kind of, you know, got my granddaddy, wasn't real crazy about it at times. You know, sometimes he'd be in his pajamas, that kind of thing. But she used to just walk in, you know, unannounced. Just walk on in the house. That's what we get to do with God. And He wants us to do that. We get to walk right into God's living room anytime we want to. We get to hang out and talk with the Lord of all creation anytime. We don't have to schedule an appointment. We don't have to wait in line. We can just walk on in like Miss Barlow used to do in my grandma's house and just have a conversation with God. How cool is that? And He knows our names. He knows our hearts. He knows everything before we even say it, right? He knows us intimately. C.S. Lewis said, God became man to turn creatures into sons, not simply to produce better men of the old kind, but to produce a new kind of man. And that's what God has done with us. He knows our innermost thoughts and desires. Some years ago now, I just think it's been a long time ago now, over 25 years ago, I had a divorce, right? It was not a pretty time for me. Ended up living in an apartment and got tired of that pretty quick, you know. But it was the best I could do on short notice. And I kept driving by on Highway 190 near Phelps, Texas, if you know where Phelps is. And I keep driving by and I see this little old farmhouse out in the pasture and had a little stock on whatever right beside it. Little, you know, gray frame farmhouse. Not very big, pretty small actually. And for some reason, that little farmhouse just, I was like, wow, I wish I had something. I'd be tickled to have something like that, you know? And so for months I'd drive by and I'd see that little house and it would just resonate in my little heart, you know, like, wow, that would be neat to just live in a little farmhouse out in the country with a stock, with a little pond out back, that kind of thing. Well, lo and behold, it wasn't, I mean, this would be many months later, 6 months later or whatever, one of the ladies I worked with, her name was Virginia, heard that I was looking for a place. And her mom had passed away recently, and they had her house that was vacant, and they wanted to rent it. And so she said, why don't you come look at my mom's house? I did. Guess what it was? It was a brick house in the middle of cow pasture with a fish pond right out back. A shed on 2 acres that were fenced out of that pasture, you know, and I thought, wait a minute, Haven't I seen this somewhere else before? I rented that house and lived in it for a couple of years. Anyway, just saying, I can't tell you how many times God's done that kind of thing for me. Just, you know, kind of those little surprises, like, he's like, I was listening. I heard you. Moved to Nacogdoches. Another one. Moved to Nacogdoches. Built a little Spring Creek subdivision, yeah. And we just weren't able to, the houses that were available in there right then were a little out of our price range. Just couldn't quite do it. Then we ended up moving across the highway, which was fine. It was good. I've been moving to Spring Creek now for what, 11 and a half years. I'm just saying, God knows the desires of your heart. And he wants to bless us, right? He wants to lift us up and give us the very desires of our hearts. Old Isaiah said in 40:31, that those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Y'all, we don't have to live in fear anymore. We don't need to feel guilty for the bad things we've done anymore. We don't need to be afraid of death anymore. For our God has conquered sin and death once and for all on the cross and in his resurrection. He fills us with his Holy Spirit, which is our down payment on life eternal. God's very own Spirit is our get into heaven free card, if you will. We're acquitted of all charges by the blood of Christ. We're God's own children. Run into your Father's arms today and cry, Abba Father, or Daddy God. He invites us all into his living room today to spend time with the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Get used to it. You'll be there for all eternity with him. So we can say with confidence, the Lord is my helper, so I will have no fear. What can mere people do to me? That's Hebrews 13:6. Thanks be to God. What a Savior we have. Celebrate the joy of your salvation today. Don has another song for us, the servant song we'll close with. So if we get that started. If you're here today or watching on Facebook Live, I pray that you open your hearts to Jesus. Let him in. Come into his living room. Know him. Be forgiven. Upon you and give you